So what I want to do today is I'm going to speak from sort of, like probably many of you, I've got different theaters and spaces. I'm doing a farm, an organic farm in agriculture called, in Ecuador called Urcahuaycu, which is not a fancy name, it's just the name of the creek where the farm is located, and everyone knows it by that name. It just means the land next to the creek. And then we have Leco Rural, which is an organization. When the NGO World Neighbors collapsed in 2008, we created two organizations. One was called Leco Rural in Ecuador, and the other one was Groundswell International, which is sort of a linkage of, a horizontal linkage of a bunch of organizations that focus on sort of people-centered development. All of us had the tradition we came from farms. I'm from eastern Pennsylvania, Lancaster County, that area, U.S., New Jersey. There's a lot of Amish farming, Mennonite farming, and a lot of family agriculture that's quite strong. And so I kind of brought that to my work in Central America and sort of had a certain attitude about rural development and how rural development needs to happen. And met people like Jackie and others who were well into that, so I found sort of a home, et cetera. And what I want to talk about is tensions that we have in the agroecology movement right now in South America. I just got back from, I live in Ecuador about 10 months a year and spend about 2 months in the Netherlands trying to share and kind of plug in with students and recruit people to come and do work where we're living on issues that we think are relevant and important in areas of, we call it agroecology. I'm not sure what term you would use because agroecology sometimes can mean gastronomy for us. It had nothing to do with agronomy. And these are things that we use really broadly. That's part of the problem right now. It's the agroecology movement. Places like Brazil and Ecuador and elsewhere is just divided. And this has all happened in the last couple of years. I can talk about that. I describe it as a divide between resistance and existence. And I want to summarize that and see if you're encountering something similar. First, I wanted to kind of get a feel for who you are, so I can kind of target this a little bit. And secondly, get a feel for how much time we have. I can go on, and I don't want to do that. What I'd like to do is sort of pique your interest and give a couple of the provocative things that at least I've been experiencing around food and agriculture, and then just kind of get your comments on that based on your own experience and suggestions you have. And I also want to spend the last few minutes introducing this book. Just because I think it's important. I'm just an editor of the book. There's 24 authors from 7 countries. I struggled, and we struggled as a group, to kind of make sense of what's going on. And we started applying feminist social perspective to understand food, not so much as a system, but rather than embodiment. We drew a lot on some theory coming out of French philosophers like Félix Guattari and Gilles Deleuze, and some of these really hardcore social theorists working on assemblage theory, working on corporalities and these sorts of things. And I think this stuff is really powerful. It certainly has transformed the way I think about food and agriculture. I find it really powerful. And so I want to share that with you and kind of expose you to this resource and this sort of literature that we're working with and where we're going now with it. So what I'd like to do is kind of quickly go around if somebody just wants to say, you know, who you are, but also what are you working on? Not bureaucratically or administratively, in your life. You know, what are you really into? In very few words. Just to give me a feel for what you'd like, how you'd like to kind of orient this as per your ongoings. Now that I've presented who I am and who Jeff is. So anyway, do you want to start in this corner, kind of wave over this way?
I'm Josh Bowen-Wilson. I'm a researcher here at CORE. I work on issues around voice and participation in policy making, looking at social movements' attempts to gain voice in policy making processes, using democratisation and food sovereignty as kind of contextualisation.
Great. Thank you.
I'm Katharina Dehlen-Schmutz. I'm a plant ecologist. I work mainly on invasive species and weeds. And so I'm not working in this area, but I'm always interested to hear what's going on elsewhere. Yeah.
Good, thanks.
My name is Joe McCrone. I'm doing a master's in agroecology here. I'm currently working on my dissertation, which is knowledge systems in agroecological farmers in the UK. I'm quite interested in food sovereignty.
My name is Paola. I'm a PhD student here at the centre. My research is on box mutants ESAs in the UK, but I'm also hoping to move back to my home country, which is Colombia, after the PhD, so I'm very much interested to find out what's going on in Latin America.
Yeah, so we're going to listen over there. Yes,
yeah, so I'm Louis Cohen and I'm a social scientist here. I'm interested in the sociology of food and agriculture, namely alternative food networks and short food supply chains. I'm really fascinated by what we're going to present today. I think this is quite related to some of the stuff I'm getting interested in.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Great.
Okay.
Appreciate that.
I'm Jonathan Eaton. I moved here 3 weeks ago. I think I was previously working in London, the KNOI. So I'm a climate scientist working in the fundamental processes group, but trying to get to grips with other things that are going on in the centre. And I have interest in understanding how crop yields in different parts of the world will change as a result of climate change, climate variability.
Good. Let's go back and we'll go forward.
My name is Chris. I'm doing my PhD with Colin and Michelle. I do participatory video making and I look at the spatial politics of food production as well.
My name is Lilian.
Yeah.
I'm a research assistant at CORE and at the same time a PhD candidate. My line of research as a research assistant, we look into what we call stabilization agriculture. Everything that is related to food security issue in disaster affected communities.
Mm-hmm.
And my line of research as a PhD candidate, I'm looking into livelihood based insects, edible insect livelihood based in the humanitarian food security response.
Hi, David Davis. I'm an interloper, I suppose. I'm a visitor with a sort of interest in permaculture and gardening and that kind of thing, but also currently part of a group that's looking to revise the agriculture policy for the Green Party in England.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
Right. And my background's been in research and international developments and organic farming and partly in South America, and I'm currently developing a research program on quantum agriculture, which is sort of using the science of quantum physics and biology to understand some traditional practices and some biodynamic farming practices which have up to now been ignored by the mainstream.
Okay.
Okay,
maybe
we'll
do this way.
I'm Paul Anderson, I'm a researcher here at CORE. I'm part of a collective or working group here called People's Knowledge, and so kind of working to support and develop participatory and action-oriented approaches to research. I'm really interested at the minute in popular education and critical learning, critical pedagogy and its role in social movements and communities and kind of thinking the political and the practical. And I'm keen to hear about what's going on in Latin America around agroecology and how that compares to some of the things we're seeing in Europe around agroecology in the UK. So.
Hi, I'm Lopa Saxena. I'm a researcher here, and the theme that I'm working on along with others is on community self-organization resilience. So under that theme, currently one of my projects is actually very close to your area of research, is looking at food and agriculture. And I'm looking at millet farming and different types of resilient food systems, and basically the different type of actors who are involved in building a movement around it, to how to revive it from where it has declined in the past few years. So it looks at these concepts of institutional mechanisms and whether self-organization works and how different contexts can influence the process by which this happens. So basically looking at how India and South America or Latin America in different contexts can give rise to different mechanisms by which these are expressed.
Mm-hmm. Michelle, anything you want to mention about what you're interested in right now in the context of this?
Lots of things, but most of my time is thinking about contested means of agroecology and also food sovereignty. So lately I've been looking very much at the politics of knowledge around, around that. I guess one theme that runs through my work is how to democratize the production and validation of knowledge, and how to bring in many different kinds of systems into the process of knowing and discovering the world. So the focus on food and agriculture, but also touches on human working and in other areas of life. It feels a lot compartmentalized.
And Jackie, do you want to add anything? Based on your PUR, your experience, to kind of position us in this talk.
Yeah, I think at the moment, the challenges I'm facing, what we're doing in Latin America, are more related to switch our perspective as people working in development, more accompany and facilitate processes, and also instead of talking too much about participation, it's more protagonism, so people are looking for their own ways to do their things, to keep producing their food and looking for other venues to do business, but as well as maintaining their culture. And the whole fact of acknowledge the social movements that are already happening. And in my opinion, I have been blind, not being able to recognize there's so many things happening, so many things people are accomplishing by working together collaboratively. The other path I'm at the moment is looking at communication and the fact that looking at the fact that we need to link people and bring them together, because we're all kind of part of a common concern is related to food, and that's probably the common ground where we can meet many of us, people from the academic sector, people from the industries, people from the rural communities, even from the industries.
Okay, great. I'm actually a plantopathologist by background. My first degree is economics. I studied plantopathology in graduate school, and then I went off the deep end and got into sociology. But I've been farming during all this. But what I'm going to be talking about here is a bit different. Like, I've done a lot of work on knowledge, but in the sense of sort of ecological literacy. A lot of my earlier work is really focused on that, developing. Applying to farmer field schools. We did 4,500 field schools in South America, starting in 1988. So working a lot with that, and with Jackie's dad, the field school movement in Central America, introducing it to countries like Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, Nicaragua. And I mainly worked in Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, Brazil, and later on we introduced them into Mozambique, into, in Africa. And so working with that. But then I got into something completely different. So I want to share that with you. Where knowledge isn't so much in your head, it's in your body, and your body is in practice. Right? What is practice? So I started getting into practice theory. And I'm working on this. It's still pretty much a body of work. We've been publishing on it. I'm going to talk a lot about effect and effective labor, which is something new we've been writing for us. It's new. Feminist social theory hasn't been around for 3 decades, but it's interesting how much resistance we're getting from people I thought were our allies. Like in Latin America, the strong sort of people who are really working a lot with communism, still, in different forms, that believe that classes exist, and you sort of have victimized rural farmers that are fighting against the system. That's how the narrative goes. And those people have really been resistant to this. And so I want to describe what's going on there. And then we have these sort of people working in this what we call this existence area, but these people are cross-cutting and looking at how farmers are teaming up with gastronomists, with things like flavor and taste, organoleptics and biochemical elements, how they migrate and colonize Europe. There's a million Ecuadorians living in Europe right now, colonizing Europe in all kinds of creative ways. How farmers colonize urban settings by moving in and taking over markets, and not in passive ways. So we've been studying that, using what's called an actor oriented perspective. The feminist social perspective is using concepts of embodiment. Bodies, in this case, isn't limited to your material, it's bodies of plural, multivocal, and distributed. So a lot of it has to do with self-organization. So I kind of want to share this language. Some of this might be useful, some of it might be kind of off the wall right now, but it's really relevant for me. As both a farmer, as an activist working in this these agroecology collectives, and as an academic. And I found that, as usual, the academic work is years, the practice is so much farther ahead than the academic work in this area. And so I really think we have to rethink the categories we're using, how the narratives, and there's a big service to play. So hopefully some of this will be relevant, but not everything. So I hope you'll be patient with me on that part. Okay. So I'm going to focus on sort of three stories to kind of emerge. I'm going to talk about Carmen Chalpa, who's my mother-in-law, and this Andean concept of sumak kase, and what that means very briefly, and how that's kind of been disturbing me for the last 20 years and living in the Andes and the indigenous community, Quechua community, and trying to make sense of how Western I really am, even though I've been 30 years working in this context. I continue to. But anyhow, this is what's opening me up to these new ways of thinking and feeling in agriculture. I'm going to focus on a campaign we have in a colectivo. We're working to recruit 250,000 families in Ecuador that spend about $600 million a year. So our approach right now in Ecuador is not so much looking for donors. We've gotten outside of working with projects. And how do we work with existing consumer wealth? And how do we get people to invest that wealth differently? And how can we mobilize that? So that's really our big project right now that I'll mention. And then the book. So that's kind of where I'll go. Just to go kind of, you know, where I'm coming from, you know, farmers are cool, white, but we do sort of a CSA, canasta every week. We have an organic farm. We call it kind of organic agroecological. You probably could pick up on what that means. We don't do just Andean crops. We do a lot of European crops. Highly degraded. Now it's, you know, we're foresting. I'd love to move towards permaculture, but we're not there yet. It's a 15-year process so far, but we've been able to, the farm has really been transformed. We have no water. We harvest about 2 million liters. We drip. And we've been able to transform sort of the desert into an oasis. It's 5 hectares, so it's pretty small, but we grow 70 crops. It's very intensive. And we service about 80 families. We need to double that. But that's where we are right now. I need to quit my job at the university so I can now get to the next level on the farm. And that's kind of our project as a family. It's a family-run farm. There's three women who work with us full time and we're four. But the motor behind it is the person in that logo. And she's 88 today. And I wanted to find this person I'll be fighting with when I get home. An 88-year-old small Indian farmer. I think she's 4 feet tall. She's tiny. And she's always doing things like planting trees in the middle where I drive my tractor, which is the conflict that's going on here. And every time I leave, I know she's got like a plan. She doesn't believe in planting in rows, you know, which I get it, you know, but the thing is when you're cleaning things, you're growing short vegetables, rows are really helpful for weeding. And so her sort of model of farming is really just, it looks like a jungle, you know. And so then, yeah, there's all kinds of conflicts going on all the time. There's another picture where you can see that her pump, an 88-year-old woman, she can pick me up still. She's incredibly strong. But I wanted to mention this concept of sumak kase. She mentioned this 20 years ago to me when I first met her, my wife's mother. And I still don't get it exactly. But what's really interesting, her comment was that sumak kase, if you ever see a picture of like Andean mythology, you usually will see some sort of a cross, and then you'll see the circle. And the circle represents kind of this sumak kase. And what that means, this kase is kind of like the seed, the middle. And her whole argument is, and one time during my birthday this came up, because I was kind of complaining about age that day. And her argument was, the happiest day of your moment of your life, the happiest moment of your life is the day you're born. Right? And when they slap you in the butt and you scream, that's her whole argument. And it was sort of like as you can feel. And that's what she was talking about. And you know, when you start to work on that idea, and she said, you know, your job is This time I was turning like 45, that's for a bit, I was depressed about my age. And he said, no, no, your job at 45 is to be able to feel with the day you were born. Right? And that's really the struggle. So it kind of gives me a notion of progress, of education. And her thing was, you know, life is about the ability at 45 to be aware of what's going on around you, to be connected to it, etc., etc. And it's interesting, because when I was writing the book, I remembered that conversation. I hadn't really thought about it a lot. Because really, I'm just getting to the point now where I'm open and capable of understanding effect. The emotion, the relationships that we're generating, not just with people, but with the soil, the organisms, with your market, with your economy, your family, your neighbors, your social networks. And this is something she's really connected to. It's not something she can even verbalize. But anyhow, I just remember that concept, and she's talking about Sumant Kalsai, and what that means. It's recently been institutionalized in the Ecuadorian constitution. But again, the state is so far off from understanding what it really means and what it implies. So I just wanted to mention that it's kind of something for me in terms of development. This really just changed my, you know, the way of, at first off, I felt really comfortable because I can, you know, I can, well, it's actually more challenging than I thought. But my understanding was, well, I can kind of relax. If I can get back to feeling pain and emotion and getting all this noise out of my head, I mean, cognitive scientists always say the problem is as we get older, we start to assume, right? And that's the difference between adults and children, is you have all these assumptions. You have this built-in experience, and you make these comparisons quite quickly, and you shut off a lot of the noise, the nuance. And yeah, you know that every time you plant a potato, you can't plant a potato the same way twice. Because every time you drop that seed in the soil, the world has changed. Right? We know what's going on microbiologically in that soil, in the environment. The world is so dynamic, but I was really so out of tune to that because, you know, you kind of assume, well, you plant these at, you know, 45 centimeters apart, I've got 65 centimeters between my rows, you know, I'm going to do it on this day, I'm going to hold it up here, and you've got this simplified system where you miss all that nuance. And I realized she's completely plugged in, and that's why she doesn't plant the vines. You know, when you go into her field, which is just a mess, you know, she's got it all micromanaged. It's just incredible. And I always know when we're lacking something for the canasta, the basket, I can always find it in her little field. You know, so I need a couple of cabbages or whatever. She grows everything in there, by the way. She's not just Indian stuff. And you can always harvest two or three to fill the canasta. It's always, it's so much more productive, you know, in terms of what she's producing by space. And it's because of the Sumant Kalsai, her ability to feel and stay connected to that. And I just thought that was an interesting concept, that we're born happy, and our job is to stay happy. Not to become happy, not to learn to be happy, etc. No. But it's also even a bigger challenge than progress as far as I'm concerned. Okay. So let's go into the background. And I guess the question for Michelle, it's 12 o'clock. You've already been here a half hour. How much time do people have? I saw they scheduled like 2 hours, and I'm happy with 2 hours. But the question is, how much time do people in the room have, and how should I organize the time?
I mean, if you could talk maybe for 4 to 5 minutes from now,
okay.
You've already taken. But that's okay.
Yeah.
And then it would be nice to have an opportunity to, you know, interact.
Yeah.
And maybe let them go for lunch at 2:30, 1:45.
Uh-huh.
But that's very flexible.
Okay. I can ease out in 45 minutes earlier. We'll do that.
If you don't mind, people who can't stay with me,
okay.
I'll probably catch up with you later in the day. But I think there will be further conversations in the afternoon. Is that sort of time okay?
Yeah. We can talk in anything you think. I'm going to cover a lot of, this is a course I teach, by the way, it's a 6-week course. So I'm just going to be glossing over some of these concepts about assemblages, about embodiments, about rhizomes, different metaphors we're using to describe multiplicities in food. Sumant Kalsai, I just talked about that. Do you kind of get that? What I'm talking, it's not progress. It's something out of it. Kind of blows your mind the more you get into it. I think it reminds me of Buddhism and some of these Asian religions. It opens up a lot of possibilities for science when you start to think about life that way. So I'm going to talk about this colectivo. And for the colectivo we created in 2005 in Ecuador, we meaning a group of activists in Ecuador, about 5 of us at that time, but we represented a lot more. It says there that it had 300 members, it's much bigger now. And it sort of teamed up with another movement, which is called MESE, which is the Movimiento de Economía Social y Solidaria, which is like this funky urban-based alternative economy. Some of them work with alternative currencies, some with organic fairs, some are working with sort of food and gastronomists. It's a really creative, some are like feminist bikers. They're trying to get, you know, taking over public space. And they've gotten this economy group. What they do is they go in at night and they repaint the roads. And they've been taking over the city of Quito and Guayaquil. And really kind of interesting stuff to reclaim public space for new purposes. They consider it a democratic movement. They describe it that way. And it is. You know, people taking responsibility for government and governance in ways that the government has not been capable of. Okay. And so they, and with that group, in 2005, and you know, of course there's decades of it, we didn't create the agroecology movement, it was well under its way. And it's not just individuals or just organizations, and you know, NGOs are sometimes involved, but we ask people in this space not to represent your NGO. You represent who you are, or your ideas and your networks. Of course, we want access to your NGO, we want access to your university. When we want to do stuff, you need access to resources to make things happen. Not just money, but spaces to meet like this, etc. Communication things. So people were plugged in all over the place. Many were farmers as well. Okay. And we shifted the language in Ecuador, right? In those days, food, well, agroecology for us was very much a agronomy. Okay, and that day we chose the word food sovereignty, which had already been, you know, circulating since the mid-90s. Actually, even before that, in Nicaragua. But anyhow, Villa Campesina, for example, kind of grabbed onto the term in 96 and used it as a flag, and that was important. And for us, it meant not just going from agronomy to food. And many of us, I had already been working 20 years in this thing. And to be honest with you, it took me 20 years to realize that agriculture had something to do with food. Because I was still focused on bugs. Pathologist and really on the micromanagement, I think that's really important, and I still do that most of my day today. But when I started thinking of it as food, and our argument was that Ecuador had been gone, the international community kind of abandoned Ecuador in those days, 2000 and 2005, for a lot of reasons we talk about, and we needed access to resources, NGOs started disappearing, but the humans stayed. You know, people from Ecuador, but also foreigners like myself and other people. Indigenous, urban, rural. And so we said we need urban people to dive into the agroecology movement or we're going to be gone. And we also realized through our analysis that we were marginalizing farmers by focusing just on agronomy. And the farmers, quite clearly in this group, were saying we want access to money, to markets. We want to be able to eat food for the first time in their lives because they thought they hadn't, you know, enjoyed food. We want access to cuisine, the flavors, the taste. And so, we coined the concept food sovereignty. We became very active in Ecuador's constitution. Ecuador is a small country, 15 million people. The country fell in 2007, the government, and the new president gave us an opportunity to participate in the Constitutional Assembly. So we camped out at the Constitutional Assembly for 6 months, and we helped to rewrite part of the constitution. So we pushed in an amendment for food sovereignty. We tried to create a Ministry of Food and get rid of the Ministry of Agriculture. We failed at that. But we did get food sovereignty inserted into the Constitution. We did a whole bunch of other things, like we wrote in measures to eliminate, prohibit the introduction of transgenics, for example, at the constitutional level. And we introduced the concept of suma causa. When I say we, I wasn't actually physically there, almost none of that time. It was me connecting to this network of activists who we all felt connected. So I don't want to take, it wasn't my leadership that did that, I was just all part of that. And actually wrote and supported some of it, but it's very much a collective effort of hundreds of people. So we felt that shift had happened in the books. Okay? The problem is, it didn't happen in practice. So in 2010, okay, the Constitution was passed in 2008, and it was actually 4 years later, we had an evaluation of what did we achieve with this brilliant constitutional work. A couple of laws that were passed later, the food sovereignty law, a law to eliminate highly toxic pesticides. There were things that we did on paper that were beautiful, but in practice, we didn't feel like we really achieved anything. So then we said, we have to focus not on the state, but the state. And from Spain, like the state with the DIGI, the institutional state, let's focus on the state of practice, the state of people. And that's where it came out in the conversation that we need to get the people we lead invested in this. Because there was no money for the NGOs for projects in this time. One of our students, one of my students, was working with Coca-Cola, as a marketing person. And they came to a meeting to talk about how much money was circulating in food. And argued that, you know, there's $20 billion circulating in food in Ecuador. How much money do you guys need to promote agroecology? And we're like, well, we'll take $1 million a year. We don't need $20 billion. And we started doing the maths. And anyhow, we came down through a bunch of debates and discussion. We need 5% of the families, because his argument was, Coca-Cola is not romantic. If you can demonstrate that there's 5% of the public that wants anything, they're going to go with that. Because they play with these small margins. Right? You don't have to get 51% of the public to decide anything. So it's very different than the state. When you're working in the space of marketing, if you can get this critical small mass that covers their margin of risk. For example, in this case, the debate was, are they going to use sweeteners coming out of remolacha, which are sugar beets, or are they going to use corn syrup based on GMOs coming from the United States? And we said, well, if you put corn syrup in there, we can guarantee you that 250,000 families or $600 million a year is what they spend will not be buying your product. Of course, we were really out of our league. We didn't have 250,000 organized. That's where we're going. And we got to the table, and we've been debating, and actually we had that conversation last week, again. So that was the goal, is we wanted to articulate a critical mass of 5% of the public who are willing to say publicly that we want that. Now, we don't know what that means. Responsible consumption is the idea. Now, that, what does that mean? That meant direct purchase. That meant eating Andean crops, and it meant organic or agroecological. And within there's a bunch of categories. And that's, but there's three things of what we're talking about. And so that's what we've been doing now. It actually got going the last 3 years strongly. And we're now really well organized. And now it's really growing. Now we have a database. Now we're creating sub-networks, et cetera. So that's kind of where we are. And I'm going to go from this experience now on the colectivo and this campaign called 250,000 Families to talk about the importance of existence. The everyday people's food consumption practice as a space of policy. Okay? Now when I'm saying policy, policy means course of action, sociologically. You can determine course of action through legislation, through paper, through administrative pressure coming from laws, but you can also determine course of action or policy through managing $20 billion a year in your economy. And the idea is, I don't think we need to abandon the states. I'm all for getting involved in legislation, but I'm also all for influencing the space of practice and what we call the social wild. Okay, the social wild is this informal space where people organize, self-organize, for example, self-finance, all kinds of good and bad things. You know, so I would argue, for example, we have the biggest pandemic in human history going on right now. We have a billion people, 1,000 million, overweight or obese. The single largest epidemic in human history, right? The most expensive one, by the way. The one that has the greatest health consequences that we've ever experienced in the human population before. And the hugest environmental impact, I think, that we've ever had in human history. Billion people, overweight or obese. I don't know a single state legislative policy that explicitly says we're going to create 60% of our population that's going to be overweight. We self-organize, we self-finance this. And it kind of goes against all the economic theory that says that people look to maximize their utility. We do sometimes look to maximize our utility, but there's a whole bunch of other stuff going on that we can tap into. In this case, for self-destructive human organization. But we also want to tap into it for things like regeneration, sustainability, health, maybe social equity. And so we're trying to study these negative consequences, not just around things like overweight obesity as an inspiration, these really bad examples of huge human innovation, but how can we tap into things like heating up the planet by 3 degrees? And some of you work with climate. Nobody wanted that. And it's actually knowable, right? It's really, we know enough now where it's possible to understand that climate change has happened, and yet we're continuing to do it. The same thing with pesticide poisoning. Pesticides today, just one class, highly toxic pesticides, kill more people than wars and homicides combined. About a million people a year. And it's knowable, right, the pesticide poisoning. When I talk to farmers who poison themselves, they know this in their heads. Of course, they don't know this in their practice, in their bodies. There's knowledge and there's knowledge. And we also know another way to obesity. If you eat and don't exercise, you'll gain weight, and that can decrease the quality of your life. It's expensive, yet we're still doing it. Okay. So these are these kind of irrational self-organization. Those are the things we're trying to get into. And to attack that, we've been using things like flavor and taste. We've borrowed, I mean, almost everything we do is borrowed. Like the field schools were borrowed. I mean, the things, you know, you contribute to. And we've also borrowed a lot recently from slow food. I was surprised in the Netherlands, people were really critical of slow food. I don't know why, but we've had a really good experience with the methodologies and the approaches that slow food does. Are you familiar with slow food? I suspect, take the transition cities. People know about these things and they're really excited about them. And often the way you experience them from a distance is different than the nuances that you guys deal with. But slow food has made a huge contribution.